Hello and welcome to Tesca Technologies Private Limited. My name is Shivam Vijay. Today in this video, I am going to giving a demonstration on process instrumentation trainer. The process instrumentation trainer consists of various knowledge about the different parts of instrumentation, in which we will see transmitters, sensors, receivers, also the indicators by which we can see the different processes like water flow, level, pressure, temperature. These four types of process which will be see how we calculate the values through the instrumentation technologies and how we see all the different types of instrument will are used in the industrial processes right now to observe and to tag the all industrial instruments and real-time measurement of all type of values. The complete training system is very useful to understand about the instrumentation technology, also in which we can understand different types of instrumentation for measurement of flow, level, pressure and temperature. The four type of sensor are also used in this complete instrumentation trainer that can be explained in the video further also, and also detail about the sensor, how they are working, I will also explain in this video, and we will see how the measurement is taken from flow in the real time measurement and how the industrial process will work. The complete system is very useful those who are studying about the instrumentation technology, automation, electrical, and also in the instrument and institution in which where the lab technicians and or other teachers are explaining the students about the different type of instrumentation in the industrial process as well. So this is the closed loop of process instrumentation trainer, in which you can see half of the part of complete process instrumentation trainer, in which some of the instruments and front panel is showing. The order code for process instrumentation trainer is 5220. You can use this order code to find out all the details and specification about the process instrumentation and what you can learn with the complete trainer. All the details about the study experiment will also present in the website, which is www.tescaglobal.com, also written on the front panel as well. This is the plant mimic on the front panel or a slide, in which you can study complete system at one place. The complete system diagram, process instrumentation diagram, is also given here, in which all the details about the instrumentation are described as in a screen. Also all the different types of measuring instruments, sum tank, level parameters and different types of values are given on the front screen. So I will start explaining you one by one all the parts and all the instruments and display indicators and different types of material what we are using in this. So this is the front panel of the complete instrumentation trainer. All the electrical connections and different types of working is provided in this front panel. This is the electrical panel of this complete instrumentation system. All the connections from different type of sensors, measurement instruments are connected here, or the displays for displaying the indication of the value are also connected inside this panel. On the front we have process indicator 1. This will indicate the flow, which is connected directly with the flow transmitter, and then is a process indicator 2, which is level indicator, in which is connected directly to the level transmitter. The level inside the leveling measurement tank will display directly by output fed from the level measurement sensor. Then this is a pressure indicator, process indicator 3, in which the pressure inside the pressure tank will be displayed. Similarly, this is the temperature indicator, process indicator 4. The fourth process temperature will be indicated on this system as well. Then this is the frequency indicator, the frequency that can be provided from any of the input. The frequency input can be provided by any function generator or any other sources that can be measured. The range of frequency input is 50 to 500 Hz. You can measure the value of the frequency, which will be converted digitally and fed and displayed on the frequency indicator. Then this is a current source. The current source is provided to operate the electronematic converter. The electronematic converter requires a fixed value of current in a range of 4 to 20 milliamperes, and after that it will opening and closing of the valve will be operated by the positioner provided on the panel. This will also describe in the video. And current source can be adjusted by this knob. Value of current can be adjusted, and there is a knob for changing the source from milliamperes to voltage. We just need milliamperes for in this practical, but you can use voltage to operate any of the system as well. The output from the current source can be connected to the any of the electromagnetic converter, heater control card, and also input of the transmitters. Then this is the toggle switch in which the current source that we are working with directly connected to the electromagnetic converter. Either you have to select the toggle switch to the electromagnetic converter if you are working with this, and if you are working with this heater control card, the toggle switch be switched to the heater control card as well. Then this is the solenoid valve on off switch. The solenoid valve is directly connected from the measurement tank, so if you on and off the solenoid valve, the water flow or the disturbance inside the measuring tank will be provided, and the output from the solenoid valve will be changed, and the level can be seen by up and down going through the level indicator as well. Then there are some different types of rocker switch in which mains on switch is provided to turning on the main supply in all the system. Then this is the 24 volt power supply switch. The 24 volt power supply is generally very useful power supply in the instrumentation section. Most of the instrumentation and sensors works on the 0 to 30 volt power supply. So 24 volt power supply is very useful in all types of instrumentation sensors. Then the next switch is for current source. The current source will be on by turning on this switch. And then this is a pump on switch. There is a pump inside the complete system which will flow the water in the complete system, which is connected with the different types of GI pipeline, and the pump will feed the water inside the complete system. The pump on switch is used here. Then this is the switch for indication on. All the process indicator will be on, turned on while we press this indication on switch. Then this is the FT on switch. Frequency transmitter inside the panel will be on when we on this FT on switch. Then both the two switches are for spare. If any of the switch is not in working or if damaged, you can change the wiring connections to the spare as well. Now we will see what inside this front panel or the electrical panel. We can see different types of connection, and you can also open the panel by unscrewing these bolts for the panel opening. Just move this in anti-clockwise direction and you will open the panel by using this handle. The panel is now opened and you can see there are different types of instruments inside the panel. So we'll explain all the instrumentation one by one. So we start with the MCB here. This is the MCB which will provide power supply 220 volt in all the circuits inside. Then these are the terminal blocks. The terminal blocks are very important aspect in which all the faults and different types of numbering and printing of the marking of the different types of connection is required. When all the different types of wires comes at a single panel, that is very important that we mark all the wire systems and wire numbers. So you can also see the how wirings are marked in the different types of panel, so that you can easily find out in the wiring diagram, electrical diagram, that some specified number of wire is directly going from here or where it is connecting from this sensor or other sensor. Then there is a relay which is required to control the action of motor in the safety purpose, that we are using a level tank, and in level tank there is a level switch so that level will not flow or exceed from the specified range or the maximum limit of the level tank, so that there will be no water flow outage in the system. Then this is the heater control card. This is the thyristor based heater control card. The input from the supply or the 4 to 20 milliampere from the RTD sensor will fed directly to the heater control card, and output is directly provided to the heater coil. The heater control card converts the 4 to 20 milliampere voltage in 0 to 220 volts in AC voltage according to the input, and the output is fed in the different types of value from 0 to 220 volt AC, so that the coil voltage is directly proportional to the temperature. If the coil voltage is higher, the temperature will be higher inside the geyser, and if the coil voltage is lower, the temperature will be lower. So this will be accumulated and worked according to the sensor input as the feedback for the measurement of temperature. Then this is a signal converter. This is just used to explain how the signal is converted from this. This is the power supply of the signal converter line in neutral of 230 volt power supply AC is connected here. The input is positive negative is directly connected from the frequency input terminals, and the output from the frequency is directly going to the indicator outside on the panel. So the frequency supply can be converted from 50 to 500 Hz. We can see how the value is converted in the digital signal, and we observed the value on the front panel as well. Then this is the SMPS. The SMPS converts the 230 volt AC power supply, 9 neutral and earth is connected here to the output of 24 volt DC at 3 ampere range. The 24 volt power supply, as I explained earlier, it is very important in the instrumentation section. The 24 volt power supply and most of the sensor works on the DC power supply of 24 volt. You can also see the complete design. It completely assembled and maintained in a cable tray, which is a PVC cable tray. You can easily turn out and see how the fault finding will be easy using this. Now after that, these are the back panel of the back side of the front panel, in which all the current sources and indicators that I have explained are connected in the front panel mounting, and all the wiring connections and switch connections are going on here. Supplies is provided in the current source, temperature and pressure level. All the sensors are connected on the process indicators so that you can easily measure and see the actual value of the measured flow and process. Now we start to see about detail about the different types of measuring sensor in this complete training system. We start with the capacitive level sensor. The level sensor is placed like this because of the transportation purpose. If the sensor is installed and assembled in the level measuring tank, it will may damage due to the transportation and due to the movement inside the complete system. So I will also explain you how the capacitive level sensor works and how we see and install the capacitive level sensor in the system. The capacitive level sensor or level transmitter generally works on the concept of capacitance, in which there is a probe in the sensor. The probe acts as a positive or negative plate of a capacitor, or the wall of the tank behave the other plate corresponding to the positive or negative plate. The positive or negative voltage on the probe will depend on the power supply that we provide to the sensor, and the power supply according to the sensor is generally converted in the electric. And when any of the medium, whatever it is, oil or water, or we can measure any of the fluid, is changes the level inside the both plates. This is a probe behaves like a positive plate, or we can say the wall behaving like a negative plate. So charge stores in the capacitance level, and capacitance value will change when the dielectric or the electric medium inside the plate will be changes. So the material of the tank need to be conductive for this, because there will be some charges storing in the capacitance level. But if the material of the wall is not conductive, we can use the reference probe over here like this. So as our tank has a plastic material, so it is not conductive material. So we using a reference probe, and when the level of the flow or the water inside this changes, so value of the capacitance will also changes, and proportional output is given to the level transmitter through the processing, and process is calibrated and the output of the sensor is calibrated according to the level. Now for installation procedure, you just need to move this cap of this capacitive level sensor anti-clockwise. The upper part and the cap of the capacitive level sensor will taken out. After that, you can see inside this there are two points at which you have to connect the positive and negative wire, which are remains free here on the top of measurement tank, level measurement tank. Then after connecting it, you will start getting the value accordance already set. But if you are not getting the accurate value, you can just change the high and lower limit by changing this trim port, or still the sensor is not going any value, is not shown on the process indicator, then after connecting supply, make sure the wire should be connected in proper sequence as described in the user manual. Also, I will explain it in the video also. Then after connecting it, fill up the level till your below part of this knob. The water level inside the tank should be touching both the probes in this. Then at this point, press L switch here. This will set your low point and starts giving the value, which is 4 milliampere for the low point. And after that, fill up the tank completely to this level at here in the full range, and then press the high switch here. The high switch will indicate the high level of the capacitor, and capacitance value according to the high and low will be calibrated, and proportional output will be given transmitted from the capacitor transmitter to the process indicator, so that you can check the actual level of the measuring tank. That's how you set the and calibrate the capacitive level transmitter. And now we will see how to install this in the system. Now for installation of the sensor inside the level tank, you see there is a hole on the upper side of this level measuring tank. Just you need to place this sensor like this, just adjust it a little bit, and you can easily place the sensor inside the level tank. Here the sensor is carefully placed. Now you should have to pass the wires through this gland over here, and wire will be passing through inside, and the connection can be made on this terminal. Now just carefully open the gland screw here, and pass these two wires from the, make sure the gland cover firstly pass through the wires, and put this pass through the wire inside the transmitter, and pull the wires till you reach the terminals, and again just tighten it. Now connect red wire to the positive point, tighten this, and black wire to the negative point. Both the indications are marked on the terminals, and now carefully tight up the gland cover. And cover the sensor with the cap that we have opened earlier. So that's how your sensor is installed. Now you can check the values on the process indicator as well. So this was the explanation about the level sensor, how we install this in the complete system. Assembling also explained. Now we can take the output from the level sensor as the level inside the level tank changes, and it will be displayed on the process indicator for level showing as well. Also, there is a solenoid valve connected behind the output valve of the output line of the measuring tank, so that solenoid valve can turn on and off by a switch, as I explained on the main panel. As we on the solenoid valve just pulls the value, and there is a plunger which is covered by a coil, which is a magnetic coil, and when we provide supply to the plunger, the coil, the plunger will be pulled when the magnetization inside the coil is formed, and this will pull the diaphragm, and diaphragm will open up the valve position of the sensor or the line inside that, so the valve will be, or the water or any fluid will be passing throughout the solenoid valve, so that can be controlled electrically by in the industry for various purpose. The solenoid valve will pass on through the level, and level will be changed, and you can observe the changing in the level on the process indicator as well. So that was explanation about the level measurement. Now we will see how the pressure transducer and pressure sensor works, rest of the sensor and working of other sensor will also explain. Now moving on, this is the pressure transducer, the pressure transmitter also we can say that. And the pressure transmitter is used to measure online as well as offline pressure in the stress industries. It gives 4 to 20 milliampere standard output for a specified range of the pressure input. For this, we are using 0 to 2.5 bar pressure output, so that at the 0 value, the output will be 4 milliampere and 2.5 bar value will be output will be 20 milliampere. That can be measured and calibrated according to the pressure. The very simple method of measuring a pressure is, it is consist of a pressure inlet. Here this is connected on the pressure inlet line. This is a pressure vessel. The pressure vessel bears the pressure generated inside the pressure vessel. Then pressure is applied through the inlet here, and which the pressure acts on the diaphragm. The diaphragm inside this is connected, and diaphragm gets deformed when the pressure is applied on the diaphragm. This causes change in strain of the strain gauge mounted on the diaphragm. The diaphragm is mounted and connected with a strain gauge. The strain gauge values will be changed, and then there is a disbalance caused in the bridge, and the further process by a signal conditioning circuit. Signal conditioning circuit is built up in the SMD component on the upper part of the sensor, and output of the signal conditioning circuit of 4 to 20 milliampere, which is proportional to the input pressure of the sensor, so that we can take output from the process indicator. Then there is pressure gauge, or the dial gauge we can say that, which is also connected on the upper part of pressure vessel. Same pressure will also applied on the pressure gauge as well. The pressure gauge can be measured 0 to 4 bar pressure, or we can say 0 to 60 psi. So that the same pressure will be applied and on the pressure gauge, and this will can be calibrate the actual value of the pressure transducer sense. So we can see actual pressure value on this. This is a mechanical dial gauge that can used and generally are in use in the industrial purpose for measurement of pressure range. Then on the lower side, this is the inlet line of this pressure vessel, and this is the outlet line of the pressure vessel. Both are controlled by ball valves, so that water flow from the pressure line is going through there, and output will be also open. The water flow remains and the pressure will be generated inside the pressure vessel, and we can see the pressure value by measured by transducer as well as on the pressure gauge. Then for temperature process measurement, we are using a geyser here. This is a electric geyser, in which when the water is flown throughout the geyser will heat up the water, and there is a coil inside this, which is a copper coil. So voltage across the coil is provided, and current inside the coil will be flow, and the coil will be heat up according to the supplied value of the heater control card, and which is a thyristor control card. So we can provide 0 to 230 volt AC as the desired set value, so that water is set and heat up according to the desired value. Heated water or warm water will be passing through this line, and at this line we have connected a resistance temperature detector. This RTD PT100 will give the output to the process indicator to see the level measurement. RTD is basically a resistance temperature detector device, which is basically a positive coefficient of the temperature, and when the temperature increases, the value of the resistance will increase in proportion with the temperature. So that resistance of the metal increase with temperature. The resistive property of the metal is called its resistivity. The resistive property defines length and cross-sectional area required to fabricate an RTD, so that all the values and according value of the material of the resistance is selected as per the process requirement. Then for flow measurement, there is a wheel flow meter is used in the line with the water flow, and the basic principle of wheel flow meter is operation of is consist of two parts. Body with pedal. This is a pedal here. You can see when the water flow from this, the pedal will starts rotating, and which is situated below electronic housing. So this is electronic housing, in which all the signal conditioning and voltage converter and frequency to voltage converter circuit is installed, so that when the field flow meter uses an optical sensor, the optical sensor and rays are passed through the wheel, and when the wheel is rotates, the value or the optical rays or the infrared rays cut by the section of the wheel, and then the cutting frequency is directly converted to the voltage by frequency to voltage converter circuit, and this is again converted to the proportional 4 to 20 milliampere output from 0 to 2000 liters per hour or whatever the flow range we are using for the measurement. So this sensor measures 0 to 200 liters per hour for the flow and works on 24 volt DC power supply, and this is a flange type or screw type wheel flow meter. Then for comparing the actual flow with the flow meter value, we have a calibrating instrument which is called rotameter here. The rotameter can be used to measure the flow, and this is an obstruction type flow sensor. In this flow sensor, an obstruction is placed in flow stream. Here you can see there is a puppet over here. So this is an obstruction in the inflow stream. When the flow is passing through the line, the obstruction will provide it. And in a rotameter, the obstruction float that rises in vertical tapered column, the lifting force and thus the distance to which the float rises in the column is proportional to the flow rate. So when the puppet or the obstruction value or the obstructor is float according to the pressure in the inflow stream, where the flow reaches or the obstruction element reaches, the value of the scale measured by the flow the obstructor will called as the flow rate. So you can see the rotameter can measure from 250 liters per hour to 2500 liters per hour. Our pump can be able to flow the water from up to 2000 liters per hour. So we can check the flow with the rotameter and also calibrate this is the actual flow by wheel flow meter, which is measured by the electrical circuit of the wheel flow meter. Now moving on to our next circuit arrangement, which is current to pressure converter. This is a device which converts the current into the pressure line. So when the current is provided in 4 to 20 milliampere range, the output is converted into 3 to 15 psi to controlling the pneumatic control valve. The input line of the AFR unit is connected through the electropneumatic converter, and this converter gives supplies to the pneumatic control valve, and then the flow is controlled through the valve. When a DC milliampere input signal is given to the coil, which is kept in a permanent magnetic field, it produces thrust which varies gaps between flapper and nozzle. This causes a change in the output pressure of the relay, which is also converted to output pressure. This pressure is fed to the bellows, and bellows exerts a force on a feedback flexure and move the nozzle and establish a throttling relationship between flapper and nozzle. And how? That's how the pressure is controlled according to the current, and output is fed to the pneumatic control valve. Now this is the pneumatic control valve, which is connected in line with the flow of the motor or the pump. And when controlling pneumatic supply, which is 3 to 15 psi output from the electropneumatic converter, is provided on the upside of the sensor, then it creates pressure from upside of the diaphragm and tries to push it down. Due to this, stream of the valve move down and control valve starts closing. The closing and opening plate of the position and opening and shut position is also given on the front panel. You can see moving this up and down in the practical as well. And same time, the feedback spring inside this is push the diaphragm up again and balance it to some position required to control the flow. So required pressure is provided to the diaphragm, and spring and pressure will balance the flow, and the position of the control is balanced according to the desired pressure and set values. Then this is the air filter and regulator unit, in which the air that is sucked by the air compressor is evidently not clean because of the presence of various type of contaminants and atmosphere. Moreover, the air is supplied to the system from the compressor is further contaminated by virtue of generation of contents in downstream. Hence, to enable supply of clean, pure and contamination-free compressed air, the air requires to be filtered. The three main elements of the AFR unit are air filter and pressure regulator. So you can regulate the pressure by turning this knob clockwise, the pressure will be increased, and when you turn this knob into anticlockwise, the pressure will be decreased. Same pressure can be seen on the pressure gauge connected to the AFR unit, and input supply of the pressure line will be provided at this inlet, and the power supply or the pressure supply is provided to complete electronumatic circuit. Then there is an orifice which is a restriction type of flow sensor which is also connected here, in which this is a H1 side, H2 side, and there are two walls on the orifice. The common method of measuring flow of liquid in pipe is by introducing a restriction in the pipe and measuring the pressure drop that result across the restriction. When restriction is placed in the pipe, velocity of fluid through increases and pressure in the restriction decreases. As flow increases, the pressure drops. Orifice plate is a head type flow meter. In these types of flow meter, a various of known dimension is involved. Variations of known dimension is involved into the pipeline. As a result, head loss of the pressure loss at the variation with the increase with the velocity, measurement of pressure drops give by the indication of flow rate. So by calculating all the aspects of this orifice on the orifice plate and the pressure drop in the system through obstruction provided through by the orifice plate can be measured by calculating all the aspects to calculate the flow rate. Then the orifice walls or upside opening of the walls is directly connected to this U-tube type of manometer. The U-tube manometer is a differential pressure measurement device for measuring the pressure difference. So pressure difference can be measured and actual pressure is measured inside the orifice. So we will use the manometer to measure the pressure drop inside the pressure, and then we can calculate the flow rate by using this manometer. And first we have to measure the liquid column height in both the arms of the manometer. The scale is also provided, and then the differential pressure is calculated using formula. Then we have a water pump here. The water pump is to flow the water inside the complete system, and this is a single phase water pump, works on the 220 volt AC power supply and has a capacity of 1 HP or 745 watts. So this will flow the water, and this is self-primed auto monoblock pump, so that there is no required for priming again and again. Whenever you want to start the experiment, you can just on the pump and water will be start flowing in the system. Then this is the sump tank here. All the water flowing through all the systems and lines will be summed into the water, and we have to fill up the sump tank up to 75% of this capacity. It can take up to 60 to 70 liters of water for the experiment purpose in the complete system. So water will be the medium, so we have to fill up the tank up to 50 to 60 liter or 75% of the complete capacity, and make sure you always fill the clean and cleared water so that no dust elements and other elements will be going in flow with the any of the equipment that may causes the damage in the sensors and other equipments as well. So this was the description of about all the instrumentation parts in the complete system and other various parts of the system. The complete parts and all the system lines and different complete various lines and components are installed on a MS study frame. Here the frame is MS powder coated and very tough and very effective frame, so that it can be easily movable and durable in the instrumentation or institution, where you can easily move the complete setup by just pulling and pushing the instrument. The wheels are provided beneath the complete setup so that you can easily move the complete functioning system to anywhere, your corridors and anywhere, room to room, so that you can easily perform all the experiment. Lock mechanism are also provided on the wheel so that system will be stable while working with the experimental purpose. Now we are going to see the experiment of real time value, and we will see all the measurement through different types of sensor in this sensor complete system, and we'll also study different types of measurement using other sensor and functioning. Now for the first practical, we are going to see measurement of flow rate using wheel flow meter. So we will use this wheel flow meter as a measurement of flow rate. Also we'll calibrate the flow rate actually with the rotameter and match up both the value by seeing the value on the process indicator for flow as well. For that, there are some valves in the complete system. The ball valves need to be at the fixed position. All the tables for every experiment, per experiment, each value or each position of the valves is given in the table. In the end of this user manual, you have to fulfill the valve position to appropriate and properly complete your experiment. Now right now on your screen, you can see all the hand operated ball valves in the complete system. So you need to set up all the valve position as described in the user manual in this table. So you have, there are 12 valves from V1 to V12, and as per the experiment, the table is given in the user manual. O means open valve, close, C means close valve, and P means partially open valve. So we have to fulfill all the condition in the complete setup as per the experiment. Now for first experiment, that we are going to this flow measurement using wheel flow meter. So first we have to open the V1, close V2, V3 need to be open, V4 close, and just need to V9 in the open condition for output flow stream, and rest of the valves will be in closed position. So same position we are going to make on the valves right now. So we just need to open the V3 valve, V4, V2 are in closed position. This is V1 valve, which is main outgoing valve from the pump. So this need to be in open condition. After that, V9 should be in open condition so that output stream flow will be directly going to the sump tank. Rest of the valve need to be in closed position. So make sure all the valves are in the closed position. When the valve handle is in perpendicular and cross-sectional line of the actual line flow, the valve is in closed position, and when the flow is in the line, the valve will be in a line position. So we have now opened the V9 and we have mistakenly closed the valve, so that is in now open condition. And now we will turn on the complete system and see how we will take measurement of the flow using wheel flow meter. Now for performing the practical for measurement of flow using wheel flow meter, we will start going follow the procedure. For this, first we have to turn on the mains, the rocker switch in the indication, then turn the bypass valve V3 and start the pump by switching on pump on. Similarly, bypass valve we have already opened. We have to turn on the 24 volt power supply and indications. Here on the indications, we can see the flow is right now zero on the flow indicator. Now we will turn on the pump and see the flow on the flow meter. Here you can see now flow starts increasing on the flow meter. The value is showing, which is 16 and 17 continuously increasing of the flow. So flow is sensed by the wheel flow meter and transmitted to the process indicator. Here we are seeing the flow meter value approximately, which is 2075 liters per hour, which is the maximum flow from the meter as all the valves are in completely open position. Now same flow rate which is measured by the flow meter, approximate rate is also shown on the rotameter. At this time you can see this is about 2170. So the flow measurement by the flow meter is almost accurate, measured by the flow meter and rotameter. You can measure the reading and note down in the user manual and observation table given in the user. Now for seeing the actual value and variation in the flow meter and the rotameter flow rate, so that we can turn this V3 valve in some close position and maintain the flow inside the rotameter. Here you can see, as I closing the valve, the obstacle sensor or the obstructor in the rotameter is going down. So we have to set the flow as a required value. So we start with setting the flow about 500 liters per hour. Here you can see rotameter is set up to 500 liters per hour, and at the same time we will also see what is flow is measured by the flow transmitter, which is given on the process indicator as well. So we'll check what the value is process indicator is showing right now. So at the process indicator we are getting almost 492, which is flow indicator, and the flow is approximately same measured by the flow transmitter. So we can note down both the readings in the observation table given: actual flow, which is shown by the rotameter, and measured flow from the flow transmitter is given in the user manual. Now we can change the flow again. So we'll increase the flow up to 750 liters per hour by changing the valve position. So this is approximately 750 here, and at the same time we see the value indicated by the flow transmitter. So value by the flow transmitter is 717. So there is some error percentage and deviation that can be measured in the flow transmitter, and that can be acceptable due to the actual value of the flow transmitter. So that's how you can take some of the readings and study the measurement of flow using flow transmitter, and calibrate the flow and match up the flow with the rotameter as well. So that's how you can take all the readings from 250, which is minimum for the flow meter, up to 2000 liters per hour, and same time take the readings of the flow indicator, process indicator 1, and match up both the value. And this is how we measure the flow by wheel flow meter. After completing your experiment, just turn off the pump. And now we will move on to our next experiment. Now for the next experiment, we are going to measure the level inside the level tank using capacitance level transmitter. So capacitance level transmitter, I have explained all about this earlier. So we are now using the capacitance level transmitter and see how the works. And the level tank has the capacity of 0 to 500 mm. And here this is a level switch provided on the upside of the level tank, so that in any case the water flow is increased and go beyond the limit of the capacitive tank or the level measuring tank, that will turn off the motor, so flow will be stopped and tank will be remain full until its limit, and this will not cause and cross the limit of the tank, so that water flow will not go out come from the measuring tank. Now for valve position, we need to close the valve V9 so that water is going through the sump tank is stopped, and we need to open the valve V10 so that water is directly flown and pressed to the measuring tank. Now as the measuring tank and the level inside the measuring tank will change, the capacitance level will change of the capacitance level transmitter, and the similar value in proportion of the current 4 to 20 milliampere is given to process indicator, and we will see how the level is shown on the process indicator, which is already calibrated according to 0 to 500 milliamperes for showing the level. We will measure and see the level inside the level measuring tank. Now we will turn on the pump, and water will be starts flowing inside the level tank, and as the level or the highest level of the tank will reach, it will automatically cut off the motor, and after that we will close the valve V10 so that water will stops due to the air pressure sucked and built up in the measuring tank, and this will stop the water level inside the tank, and we will check the level and match the level with the level indicator and on the scale indicator of the level measuring tank. So we'll turn on the pump and see how the level will start and water flow inside the water tank. Here you can see water starts going flow in the water tank, and level is also sensed, and level will shown on the level indicator as well. This is the process indicator which is showing flow because the flow meter in the line is still working. And as we completed the flow and the water level will be reached to maximum level, we will close the valve V10 and then we'll operate the solenoid valve to change the level of the measuring tank inside the measuring tank level. Here you can see as the water level goes up beyond the limit, it will automatically turn off the motor. Here you can see the motor is turned off, and again if the water level goes below the level changing, you can see by changing the level here, by opening the valve V1, if the valve is opened completely, the level goes down, and again if I close the valve, the level inside again start increasing, and when it reaches the maximum limit, it will automatically cut off the motor or the pump. At this position, we will turn off the valve V10 and turn off the pump as well, so that motor will not start working. And now we will use solenoid valve switch here to turn on the solenoid valve, and water from the measuring tank will start flowing down to the sump tank, and level inside the water will be changed. Now you can see the water measurement through the water leveling scale is almost 450 and 455 according to the level measuring tank, and same time the level measured by the capacitance level sensor is transmitted to the level indicator, so we can see the actual level of the level transmitter is also given, which is 456, which is almost accurate. Here the level indicator is showing 456. Now we will turn on the solenoid valve and water will start flowing out from the measuring tank, and here you can see water level is decreased. So we will turn off the valve again at some specified position. Let us say we will turn the valve about 400 sensed by the level transmitter, and we will check what is the actual level of the level transmitter. Now I have closed the valve, but we will wait till the actual value is transferred from the transmitter. Here the value is now stable, so 393 is the output level from the level transmitter, and at the same time we will see the level, what is the level inside the level scale. Here you can see the level is almost 390, which is plus minus 3% error of the output here. So we are getting accurate level measurement of the level sources. So both the readings you have to maintain in the observation table so that your level measurement experiment will be fulfilled. Again, we will try to take some more reading. I have turned on the solenoid valve, and we will turn off the solenoid valve around 350. For matching up the 350 level, we have to close the valve more than 350 level so that transmitter delay will be fulfilled. I have closed the valve and the level is stabilized on 340 mm. Now at the same time, we will see level inside the level tank is almost 347 or 46, which have almost 3 to 4 mm error, which is approximately correct. The error can be also minimized by trimming the port of the capacitance level sensor so that you can easily measure the level, and accurate level will be measured through the level transmitter. So this was the level measuring experiment by level transmitter, which is capacitive type level transmitter. After completing your experiment, you can drain out all the water inside the measuring tank by opening the valve V1, so that all the water is drained out in the sump tank, and you can move to the next experiment. Now for next experiment, we will measure the pressure using pressure transducer or pressure transmitter. For this, we have to provide a pressure by water flow inside the pressure vessel, and the pressure transducer will give the output in 4 to 20 milliamperes current range, calibrated output of changing the bridge inside the strain gauge, which is a material and a resistive element and signal conditioning circuit inside the pressure transmitter, and this will describe on the pressure indicator over here, and we will see and check the water flow or the pressure accurately in the pressure measurement. For that, we have to open the valve V3 and start the pump, and then the pressure inside the pressure vessel will also seen on the pressure gauge, dial gauge, and by which we will adjust the pressure and calibrate the pressure measured by the pressure transmitter with the pressure gauge. Now for measurement of pressure, we have to also open the valve V7 here so that water flow will completely go inside the pressure vessel, and open the V8 in first condition so that water flow is completely going from in to out by inlet to outlet, and then we will start closing the V8 and pressure will start generating inside the pressure vessel. So we'll turn on the pump. Once the flow is maximum on the flow meter, we will start closing the pump and try to maintain the pressure about 2.5 kg per centimeter square or 2.5 bar, we can say, by closing the ball V8. Here the water flow is now maximum, about 2000 liters per hour. Now we can start increasing the pressure inside the pressure vessel, and same will be displayed on the pressure gauge as well as measured by the pressure transducer. This will give output to the process indicator 3 for pressure indicator. Now I am start closing the valve slowly, and in some time here you can see pressure starts increasing also on the process indicator as well. So we have to maintain the pressure approximately 2.5 bar . So this is 2 bars, 2 kg per centimeter square, and this is 2.5 bar approximately in the pressure vessel. Do not exceed the pressure more than 2.5 bar. So this is almost the complete transmitting level value of the pressure transducer. Right now the current is transmitting is 20 milliamperes to the process indicator. So you can see the pressure is maximum, which is the range of pressure transducer. Now the similar pressure is also showing at the pressure transducer. You can take a closer look of the pressure gauge as well. Here the pressure is almost 2.5 bar and same value is showing at the pressure transducer as well. The process indicator. Now we will change the pressure and match up the value. For this, we just try to open the valve and decrease the pressure. Here you can see, if I open the valve and maintain the pressure on the pressure gauge approximately 2, the same value is also shown at the pressure transducer indicator. You can take up the readings and note down it in the observation table so that your experimental reading will be fulfill your experiments. Now we'll change the pressure again to 1.5 bar. This is approximately 1.5 bar by closing and opening the valve V8, and same value is also shown at the 1.5, 1.46, which is approximately same value output of the pressure transducer. Now for one more reading, we can take the value of 1 bar pressure. Here the pressure reading is 1 bar. And same reading is approximately shown on pressure indicator. So that's how you fulfill and conduct your pressure measurement experiment using process instrumentation trainer. After completing the experiment on taking all the readings, just turn off the pump. Also, completely open the valve V8 so that residue water inside the pressure vessel will go down and drain out in the sump tank. Now for next experiment, we are going to measure the temperature using temperature transmitter. The RTD, resistance temperature detector, is the transmitter for measurement of temperature. Here we are using a geyser, and a current source is required to provide the current to the heater control card, which I have explained in earlier in this video. The heater control card then after will give the appropriate and proportional output to heat up the coil element inside the heater or the geyser, and water will be warmed according to the provided value. So we can set the temperature, appropriate current will be provided, and we can see the value temperature at the different current value, and the temperature will be increased in the proportion, so that the resistance temperature detector will measure the sense and sense the temperature of the water and provide it to the process indicator. For current source, we have to connect the patch cords provided in the panel to T1 and T2 with the ground and milliampere terminal, like this. After connecting both the patch cords to the millivolt calibrator, turn this selector switch to the milliampere setting and turn on the CAM current source switch on. Here you can see the current and milliampere volt value is right now zero. As we turn this knob, the current value will be increased. Also, we need to change this knob to the heater control card because we are working with the heater control card. So this toggle switch to be set to heater controlling card. So right now value is 0.2. We can increase the value in some proportion by this knob provided on the current source. Also, we need to turn on the pump, and then we had to set the pressure or the water flow approximately 250 liters per hour because the lower flow is required to heat up the water in the continuous instance, so that as lower the flow, the heating will be proper. Now we have to turn on the pump first. The pump is turned on, and we need to maintain the flow approximately 250 liters per hour using valve V3. So we'll close the valve and maintain the flow. Approximately 250 liters per hour, which is the minimum flow for this. It can be below 250. We need to flow the water from the geyser as well. For this, just turn on the valve V5 and turn on the valve V6 so that water will start flowing through the geyser, and close the valve V9 so that direct outlet from the water will not in continuation and maintain the flow. The flow indicator will help you for this. For this we have to turn the flow approximately 250 or below 250. So this is the flow right now, sensed and measured by the wheel flow meter. Maintain the flow approximately 250. So this is now almost stabilizing. At this instance, we can turn on the heater MCB. The heater MCB is provided on the left side of the front panel. Make sure you always on the heater MCB while pump on. The pump need to be on so that heater or water will be inside is in continuous flow of the geyser. Now I've on the heater MCB. There is red indication showing on the heater right now, and if I increase the current up to 4 milliampere, the water temperature is showing, which is 22, is the actual atmospheric temperature right now, and we will increase the temperature in accordance for starting providing the value from 4 milliampere. And we have to take the reading in every 5 minute interval because it takes some time to heat up the water inside the geyser, and continuous flow of the water will be maintained at same water temperature. Here you can see the value is provided 4 milliampere, so that some amount of current is providing to the heater control card and proportional output is providing to the heater coil. Now I will increase the output up to 8 milliampere. Here the output current is now 8 milliampere, and in some time the heater or water will be starts increasing to heat up, and same water level will be sensed by the heater element or the resistance temperature detector, and which will be described and displayed on the temperature indicator. Here after 5 minutes of the continuous process, the water temperature has been increased to 28 degree right now, and now we will increase the current to 12 milliamperes. Here the value of the current is now 12 milliampere, and in again another 5 minutes you can take the reading of temperature, what will be the temperature and increased by the geyser. Here the water temperature is increased up to 29 degree centigrade. Now for another reading we can increase the temperature up to 16. You can increase the temperature as your required set point current value. Now I have increased the temperature to 16, and in some time again water temperature will increase, sensed by the RTD. The resistance temperature detector, the value of the resistance change according to the temperature changing. As the temperature increase, the resistance value is also increased, which is in conditioning circuit again calibrated with the temperature process and temperature controller. Now temperature is increasing, which is 30, and after 5 minutes you can again take the readings for different values. Here the temperature is now 33 degree. Because of time limit, I am taking the reading in some 2 to 3 minutes time interval, but you can take the readings up to 5 minutes or more than 5 minutes for a proper and accurate reading. Now I am increasing the temperature or the current value to 20 milliampere, which is the maximum current value for the heater control card, do not exceed from this, and at this instant the complete 220 volt power supply is provided to the heater, and this will increase the complete maximum temperature of the heater or the water. So all the readings need to be mentioned in the user manual, at which current value, which temperature you are getting. So all readings should be mentioned, and that's how we control the temperature, and the measurement of temperature will be done by resistance temperature detector, which is temperature transmitter for this instance. After taking down all the readings of the current versus temperature, you can draw the temperature and current graph. You will find an exponential increasing graph of the temperature. And after completing the practical, taking down all the readings, first turn off the heater MCB, then turn off the pump. So we have turned off the heater MCB now, and now we can turn off the pump, so that there will always water inside the geyser while we turn on the heater supply, so that it will not burn inside the heater coil. Now for next practical, we are going to measure the flow using orifice plates and U-tube type manometer. This is a very earlier method to measure the flow. In the earlier days, when the industrial purpose and the industrial and technology were not efficient to measure the different types of processes, like today we are measuring the flow using wheel flow meter, measuring the pressure using pressure transducer and different types of technological enabled components. In the earlier days, for measurement of flow, this method was very efficient to do the flow calculations. And nowadays still some of the scientists and some of the processes and some of industrial methods, this method is generally used and taken in practice for calculation of flow. So we will also introduce this method in this complete setup as well to measurement the flow, which is a very efficient and calculative way to calculating the flow. We will also match up the flow with the actual wheel flow meter value or the rotameter value as well. So for working with the U-tube manometer and rotameter, we need mercury in some of the amount to fill up the mercury in the U-tube provided here. The manometer works on the height changing when the pressure is dropped. When we flow the water through the orifice plate, the orifice plate has a valve A and B on both sides. This is the pressure, higher pressure side, and this is the lower pressure side. When the water is flowing, there is an obstacle inside the orifice. The water will be as obstructed, the pressure of the water will be down and flow rate will be increased. And the other side, similar pressure drop will be observed through the U-tube here, which is connected directly to the H1 and H2. Before that, we will measure the H1 and H2 height and fill up the mercury inside the U-tube, so that both the levels of the mercury value will match up. And when the pressure changes, this will increase and pressure is provided on the mercury. Mercury will remain inside and water will be flow in continuous flow in both the walls, and mercury level will be changed in both the sides. So we will measure H1 and H2 readings will be taken, and then we'll check the delta H by subtracting the higher value with the lower value, and then we can calculate further calculations given in the user manual. For calculating the flow with the manometer and orifice, we have to first turn off the pump, turn on the pump and maintain the pressure about 250 liters per hour, which is a lower for this, and then we again turn off the pump by as explained in the user manual. After that, we have to connect P1 with the H1 here and P2 with the H2 here, and we have to fill up the mercury as I explained, and we have to open the ball valves P1 and P2 on the manometer and see the mercury level in the tubes get matched by filling above the mercury, and we have to remove all the air bubbles inside. Then we have to close the valve P1 and P2 and open the valve A and B on the orifice. In the starting, we have to open the valve in minimum flow rate, and then we will start the pump at 90% opening of the valve V3. In this setup, right now we do not having mercury because it requires lab license to perform the mercury experiment, and mercury cannot be supplied with the system or the complete setup as well. Mercury you have to purchase your own and perform the experiment with this. Now I will just explain you how to do calculation of the reading after taking the reading of height H1 and H2, so that calculation will be help you to find out the flow rate accordingly. After taking the reading of H, when pressure drops, del H will be calculated on the scale of YouTube manometer, and flow rate of the rotameter will be calculated by the formula given. There is some careful notations will be provided. So while varying the flow, any exceed beyond the liter per hour minute, about 750 liters per hour, or improper valve opening may lead your mercury lost in the process line. So make sure while working with the mercury, this will be harmful. So make sure any professional to conduct this experiment with the mercury in under guidance of any professional. So you need to match the flow with the flow meter while working with this, and after taking the readings you have to calculate the calculation using this formula given here. I will explain you this also. There is value of K, which is a constant value, need to be taken for this. We have taken the value for this is calculated according to the design of orifice, which is 0.9 for this, where D is the diameter of pipe, which is 25 mm, and this is complete calculation is indicated and described about the 500 liters per hour flow, and small d is the diameter of restriction area at vena contracta of the orifice, which is 12 mm, which is as per design of the orifice here, and G is the acceleration due to gravity, which is 9.81 meter per second square, or we can convert it to 7 centimeter, which is 981 centimeter second per second square. For 500 lph, del H reading on the manometer is 15 mm from above table that we have already taken in the test experiments. And H1 and H2 value equals to 9 for this value. Now for step 2, formula for flow through the differential pressure type flow measuring instrument is Q actual equals to K multiplied by A2 square root of 2G under multiplied by del H divided by square root of 1 minus A2 upon A1's whole square. So A1 here is the area of pipe, which is pi D square by 4. We can calculate the area of pipe because diameter is provided, which is 25 mm, or in centimeter 2.5 centimeter, so area can be calculated, which is 4.9087 centimeter square. Then we can also calculate the area A2, which is area of restriction at vena contracta office orifice, which is in which D is the diameter of restriction, which is 12 mm, 1.2 centimeter in the centimeter value, and we can calculate it also. A2 equals to pi small d square upon 4. By calculating this, we can get the area, which is 1.1309 centimeter square. Then from equation, after that we can conclude it, A2 upon A1 equals to 0.2304 by getting both the areas from equation 2 and 3, and A2 upon A1 square can also be calculated, which is whole square of 2.2304, and which is 0.0531, and then we can calculate it 1 minus A2 upon A1's whole square, which is in calculation equals to 0.947, and square root of 0.947 is equals to 9731. So this is the calculation of lower side of this equation that have been completed. Now we can see A2 divided by this complete equation that we have already calculated is equals to 1.1309 divided by 0.9731. So thus this value comes out to be 1.1622. Here this value to be put in the equation 1, there g equals to due to gravity, which is 981 centimeter square, so square root of 2g equals to 44.29, and then substituting value in the equation 1, we will get similar calculation output of the Q ideal, which is 154.42 cubic centimeter per second. This value then now can be calculated by actual flow. The actual ideal flow can be multiplied by 0.9, which is converting in the liters per hour. We will get 138.9 for this. 0.9 is the K that we have already explained earlier, and then converting it well, this value from cubic centimeter per second square to liter per hour, we can get 500.29 liter per hour. Hence we can conclude that and observed value and calculated value for orifice plate are approximately similar. So that can be calculated by orifice and U-tube type manometer. That was the complete explanation of calculating the flow by using orifice and manometer. In this, you can calculate the flow rate for different flow values. Also match up the actual calculated value with the flow indicator here, the measured flow from the wheel flow meter as well. Now we move on to our next experiment, which is measurement of pneumatic control valve. The pneumatic control valve will be controlled by electro-pneumatic converter by providing current by current source, as we provided current source to the heater control card. Similarly, we will provide current from the current source to the pneumatic controller. We need air supply to control the air pneumatic control valve. So air supply will be connected to the APR unit. Then we will provide appropriate pressure to the electro-pneumatic converter. Then supply will be provided to the output of the electro-pneumatic converter is provided in the air foam or pneumatic foam to the electro-pneumatic valve, and opening and closing will be controlled according to the current supply. We will also measure the actual flow rate will be changing, when the valve closing and opening will changing. First we need to connect the air supply from the compressor output to the APR unit here, like this. This is a U-tube fitting or PU fitting of 6 mm diameter, and some extra wire or extra PU tube is also provided for expenditure of your compressor and fitting for providing the pneumatic supply to the system as well. Now as I turn on the air supply, you can see the pressure gauge is showing some value of the air pressure. Now we have to adjust the air pressure about 2 bars by turning this knob anti-clockwise. If you turn this knob to clockwise, the pressure will increase. So we now want to decrease the pressure, so I am turning this knob into anti-clockwise. For maintaining the pressure about 2.1 kilogram per centimeter square, this is the required pressure to operation of the pneumatic control valve. So that we have set the value. Now you press the knob so that actual pressure will be logged. Now we will provide current source connecting the patch cords through the electro-pneumatic T1 T2 terminal and turn the toggle switch to the electro-pneumatic converter. Now as we have done in the heater control card section to providing current from the current source, similarly we will connect black wire with the ground and red wire with the red pin, which is milliampere slot. Now turn this switch to the milliampere similarly, and the knob will be required to change the current value accordingly. Also you need to put this toggle switch to electro-pneumatic controller. Now it is on heater control card, so we'll now change this to the heater electro-pneumatic converter. This is our electrical connections that has been completed right now. Now we will set up all the valve positions according to the practical and according as described in the user manual. Then we will start controlling the supply. The flow will be changed when the valve position is up and down. Now we have to set first the water flow about 2000 liters per hour so that we can control the flow by pneumatic control valve and see how the flow decreases when the valve closes. So that for that V3 need to be in open condition. This is the bypass valve and we need to turn off the V2 and V4. Both the valves need to be in closed position so that water will not flow from here. The bypass valve need to be completely open. Then we will control valve V1, the main incoming valve from the air pressure from the water pump, so that water flow will be directly controlled with the V1 valve. Now we have to turn on the pump and set the water flow near about 2000 liters per hour while matching the water flow in the process indicator, the flow indicator that we have explained earlier. Also make sure valve V9, the outlet line of the complete setup from the flow meter and the flow transmitter going through, will in the open condition. Also make sure valve A and B of the orifice need to be in closed position so that there will be no extra pressure created inside the manometer and some of the mercury causes and the mercury loss causes will not happen. Now we'll turn on the pump and see water flow on the reading of process indicator 1. Let it increase completely, then we maintain the flow near about 2000 liters per hour by changing the valve position of valve V1. Here you can see the water flow is about 2060-65. We'll maintain the water flow near about 2000 by just decreasing the flow by closing the valve V1 . So this is approximately 2000 liters per hour. The error of some plus minus 2 or 3 liter per hour will be happen. This will be considerable here. Now we need to turn off the pump again and open the valve V2 and V4 from the pneumatic control valve, and then we provide current from the current source and operate, see how the valve position will be close and flow of the line will be decreasing. Now we'll turning off the pump and now we will turn V2 open, V4 open and V3 in closed position so that now water flow from the pneumatic control valve will be start. Now we will turn on the pump again and provide current source from different values of current. Then we see how electropneumatic converter will be convert 4 to 20 milliampere to 3 to 15 psi, and this psi pressure of the air pressure will be provided to the diaphragm, and diaphragm will close the valve which is connected directly with the rod in the valve position. Now you can observe the flow on the flow indicator is 2000 liters per hour. Now as we start providing current from the current source, the flow will start decreasing as the valve position, as we provide current, will start closing, because electropneumatic converter will provide some pressure to the diaphragm of the pneumatic control valve and it will start closing in proportional with the current increment. So till 4 milliampere there will be no as much difference in the wall position and then the flow as well. Here the value is now 4 milliampere and there is some slight difference in the flow, about 15 to 25 liters per hour. Now flow is indicating 1960-70 around. Now I will increase the current some little, about 1 milliampere. This is now 5 and the current and the flow is now decreased by 10 liters per hour, which is now 1956. Now if I increase the current some more up to 6, the current, so the flow is right now 1926, again it's now decreasing in proportional with the current. Again we will increase the current from 6 to 8. So at 8 milliampere the wall position has been closed in some percentage amount. You can also calculate the percentage amount of the wall closing by decreasing the flow and calculating the percentage value. This is now 1860. Take both the readings of current and flow in your observation table, so that will be help you to plot the graph. Now increase the current up to 10 milliampere and flow still continue decreasing, and when it be stable you can take the reading. So this is 1750 around liters per hour. Now if I increase current up to 12, the flow is right now 1500 liters per hour, which we have decreased the flow approximately 500 liters per hour by closing the pneumatic control valve, and the process is very smoothless and very smooth process has been done because the electropneumatic control valve is working in a very smooth process, so that water flow will be smoothly controlled and as desired value we can set the water flow using this type of electropneumatic control valve with the instrumentation technology. Here now I've increased the current up to 15 milliampere and water flow is showing about 1200 liters per hour. We have decreased approximately 800 liters per hour using the electropneumatic control valve. At 17, water flow is almost half of the first rating water flow, which is right now 950 liters per hour. And now we'll completely provide 19.99 milliampere, which is approximately 20 milliampere, and this is the maximum current to be provided on the electropneumatic converter. So here you can see at 19 milliampere, which is a 20 milliampere almost supply, so that we have controlled the flow from 250 liters per hour to 2000 liters per hour. If we decrease current again, the valve opening will be going on and flow will be increased in correspondence and proportional amount. So you now I will show you how the valve is working in this complete setup. I will start decreasing the current, you will see valve will be in opening and flow on the rotameter you can also observe, which is increasing. So here you can see in this frame The electromagnetic control valve is now almost at the shut position. This is the plate will connected with the scale position here. So this will describe you opening and closing of the valve position. This is now almost closed position as the plate or the mark is about the shut position right now, and also flow in the rotameter is a minimum. Now I will start decreasing the current in some proportion, and you will observe the valve starts opening accordingly. So now I am decreasing the current from 20 to 16 milliamperes, and you can observe the valve is going up. The scale or the rod of the valve, you can consider this. And similarly, rotameter pressure, flow in the rotameter is also increased in some amount. So this is approximately 600 liters per hour right now. Flow has been increased. Now I will change the current again from 16 to 12 milliamperes, and at some same proportional amount you are observing the valve opening of the pneumatic control valve, and flow is also increasing, which is now about 1200 liters per hour. And again, if I decrease current from 12 to 8 milliamperes, the flow is again increased as I removing the current and the flow range, controlling the flow range, providing it to the electromagnetic converter, and appropriate pressure is provided from the electromagnetic converter from 3 to 15 psi, and flow is controlled accordingly, and valve position and opening is also controlling. So flow is right now about 1700 liters per hour, 1750 around. Again, if I decrease the current from 8 to 4 milliamperes, so we can again get the appropriate opening of the valve, and flow is almost right now 1900 liters per hour. By adjusting the current and decreasing the current some more, we can get the actual 2000 liters per hour from where we have started. So I have turned the current knob completely to zero, and flow is near about 2000 liters per hour again. And valve of the pneumatic control valve position is completely in the open position right now. Similar value and similar operations can be controlled by PID controller using, and appropriate controlling by feedback control also can be covered by controlling these type of electro-pneumatic converters and instrumentation technology. So this is a very useful innovations nowadays to controlling the water flow and different pressures. You can also observe the current is zero right now and flow is 1960. So that's how we have completed the practical of using electro-pneumatic converter to position the valve position of electro-pneumatic control valve, and have we control the flow according to the valve position by providing the current from the current source on provided on the front panel. The electro-pneumatic control valve or these types of instrumentations are very useful in the industrial purpose to maintain the desired flow at desired value. Also, you can control it from the PID controllers for the PLC or any of the monitoring like SCADA and other devices, DIQs like that. So that this is the very important processes and very highly efficient method for controlling the flow in the industrial purpose automation, industrial automation related working. So that's how we control the flow using this. Now we move on to the next experiment, in which we will see how the frequency is transmitted. The frequency is generated from the function generator. We required a function generator for this experiment as well. And then we provide the output of the function generator to the terminal T3 and T4 for frequency converter, in which there is a signal conditioner or signal transmitter inside that. I have explained earlier for this. When we provide frequency from 50 to 500 Hz, which is already set value in the process indicator, this will generate an output of 4 to 20 milliampere accordingly and give it to the process indicator. And as per the output, the proportional value of the 50 to 500 Hz will be displayed on the process indicator 5 or the process frequency indicator as well. Now we are going to see how the frequency is transmitted from the function generator and displayed on the frequency indicator. So in the last experiment for this complete process instrumentation trainer, the frequency transmitter working we will see in this experiment. For this we required a function generator to generate a fixed amount of frequency like this. So this is the function generator that I am using here, and it can generate a sine frequency from a specified range, but we need the function generator which can generate frequency from 50 Hz to 500 Hz for the response of the frequency transmitter. Now for setting up the experiment, we just need to turn on the mains 24 volt power supply, indication switch and frequency transmitter switch to be on. So frequency will be shown here. Then we have to connect using a patch code the output of the frequency transmitter to the terminal T3 and T4 for the instance. And now here you can see, as I said, the frequency in the the function generator, which is 50 Hz for this minimum. 50 Hz to 500 Hz frequency we can provide here. So this is showing 50, which is converted according to the signal converter in the digital signals. Now the frequency, if I increase the frequency from the function generator, you can also observe the output in proportional, same output will be given on the process indicator as well. Now if I change or increase the frequency from the function generator from 50 to 100 Hz, the same frequency will be also displayed on the process indicator or frequency indicator output, which is 100 right now. You can see just a fluctuation of 1 Hz on the frequency indicator as well. Now if we again increase the frequency from 100 to 200 Hz, same output will be displayed on the frequency indicator. So this is 200 Hz here. Similarly, if I increase the frequency in between 200 to 250, here I have increased the frequency about 250 Hz, this time will increase a lower amount. So same output is displayed on the frequency transmitter as well. This is 249.50 around, same output on the process indicator as well. Now I'm increasing the frequency again from 250 to 350 now. Same output is also on the process indicator. And now if I increase the frequency about 500 one by one, you can also observe the output is increasing. This is 440 from here, 460, 70, 80, 90. Now this is almost 500 now. So there is a deflection of 3 hertz here. Now if I increase the frequency more than 500, you will getting the process transmitter will be going in overload condition. It will display till some range, and after that the current providing through the frequency transmitter is in the high condition. So the last appropriate value we can measure from the frequency transmitter is 550 hertz. Now similarly, if we decrease the value about less than 50 hertz, so that lower limit will be crossed and we can observe the output. Is out from the range. This is input low frequency. So this is the lower value here that displaying the output. So the lowest frequency that can be take from the frequency transmitter is 50 hertz for this instance. So that's how signal converting and signal conditioning works in the different types of instrumentations. As we provide the frequency in the analog form, this is converted in the 4 to 20 milliampere value, and the same 4 to 20 milliampere value is giving to the frequency indicator or the process indicator here, and it is calibrated according that if we get 4 milliampere on the process indicator, it will show you 50 hertz for the lower amount and the lower limit, and if it get the 20 milliampere, it will show you 550 or 500 hertz for the instance. So that's how the signal conditioning and scaling works in the process instrumentations. So this was the complete demonstration of process instrumentation trainer, in which I have tried to explain about all the details in which we are using different types of instrumentation, and also to see how the process is controlled and how we measure the different values or different process values in which we have used instrumentation, and the different type of sensors and level transmitters, also the heating elements through the geyser and the level measurement, and also the electromagnetic controlling I have explained completely in this video. So I hope you have got the complete information how to do practicals on this complete trainer and how to study the different types of instrumentation technology. All other details about the theoretical and how to working with the different instrumentations are also given in this user manual. You can study deeply for this. And if you like our efforts of explaining the complete system here and to explaining the different types of working in the instrumentation, and if it is useful for you, you can also refer this to and share the complete video with your colleagues, with your students, with your classmates if you are working with them, or some of the your known is working with the instrumentation and want to get knowledge about the automation and different types of industrial instruments. You can also refer the videos to them. And if you like the video, you can please press the like button and also subscribe our channel to get the other information, and also press the bell icon. Don't forget to press the bell icon. If the next video when we upload this, you will get the notification properly. Till then, if you find difficulties while working with this, you can contact to Tesca Technologies Private Limited for all types of supports and to get details about the complete system as well. So thanks for watching. See you in the next video.